Okay, so I'm in the process of taking down this engine out of my wife's Blazer. And there's a couple things I wanted to point out when you're taking these things apart. I've got all the bolts out of the intake, but this engine had a lot of corrosion in it. And whenever you're taking this engine apart, it's really important to inspect all the nuts and bolts. As you can see right here, how this bolt is corroded away. Now, I put this on the grinder already. But it's important that you check this, because if you go to torque this thing back down, you may snap it off if you don't really clean these bolts good and look for stuff like this, because this can really put a dampener in your day if you torque that thing down, snap one off, and have to take it all back apart and get that bolt out of there. And it's just something to look for when you're doing these. Another thing that I do is I haven't marked the block yet, but I've marked the heads, because when this thing goes to the shop, when I get it back, I can look for the marks that I put on the casting to make sure it's the one I sent in. This one right here, I just put two, so you can see that or not. I'm trying to zoom in. I just took a punch and put two punches on that hump on the head right there. And on the passenger side, I just put one, okay? That's so I can know which head went on which you can turn these heads around. I believe you used to be able to. The bolt holes, yeah, you can just turn these heads around. It doesn't matter which side they go on. I believe they have the same casting. No, they don't. Yes, they do, because you have this plug right here for the sensor over here, the temp sensor. Okay. Speaking of the sensors on this thing, this one had a bad oil pressure sensor, which is right here. The gauge inside was fluctuating, like bouncing around and stuff. So it was a bad sensor. This sensor needed to be replaced. But as you can see, it's broken. Okay, I hit it when I was taking it out and broke the sensor whenever I was pulling the engine out. I didn't care whether this thing was broken or not, because I had to replace it anyway. I knew that. But it's a good idea to remove these sensors that you might break whenever you're pulling the engine out, because if you don't, this thing's probably $40 or $50 for this stupid sensor. So it's a good idea to remove the stuff that you might break whenever you're pulling these things apart. So this is where I'm at right now. I've got all the bolts out of the intake manifold. I'm gonna pull the intake and then separate the plenum from the intake and get it out of the way, because I want to get the heads off this thing and have a look at what's going on inside this thing. See how it's worn and what exactly I need to do to it. I'm going to send the heads to the shop, not to do the valve job. I'm going to do that myself, but to resurface the head. I want to probably mill 10 thousandths off the head, 10 thousandths off the block. So when I put this thing back together, I've got a good smooth, good smooth gasket surface. So this is where I'm at. When I get further along, I'll make another video, point out some more stuff for you guys to contemplate. Yeah, I guess that's about all for right now. So, all right, holler at you in a little while. Peace out. Okay, so a couple more things I wanted to point out here on tearing this engine down. One thing you don't want to do is you don't want to mix up these rocker arms with the rocker balls. Doesn't matter so much which valve spring it sits on, but you don't want to mess up the, I'll show you what a rocker ball looks like. Rocker arm sits on there, and there's a cavity in there that's machined to fit this rocker ball right here. It just sits down there, and the nut sits on top of it. But you don't want to get them mixed up. You want the rocker balls to remain on the same rocker arm that it came off of. And I can't get this. Yeah, no, okay, to hell with it. I ain't messing with it. Another thing to point out. Now these are just nuts that hold the rocker arm in tension on the push rod. I'm gonna take this one all the way off. Anyway, yeah. Anyway, the rocker arm just holds tension on the hydraulic lifter. So you gotta take those nuts loose enough to pull the push rod out. Push rods don't matter where they go. They're the same length. So exhaust intake's the same. It doesn't matter. You can mix and match. As long as they're straight, you need to check them to make sure they're not bent. And as long as they're not damaged in any way. You can put them wherever you want. This engine has a roller cam. See if you can see the roller under that. You might be able to see that one. Anyway, you can see where it's rolling on that cam lobe right there. I thought you'd be able to see that a little better. Might be able to see that one. Gosh, no, that's the top of the dim. Anyway, this is a roller cam, okay, on this engine. And so it's going to be important to put those hydraulic lifters back on the same lobe they came off, because it's already got a wear pattern on there for that lobe. And if I go mixing and matching the hydraulic lifters, then it could cause that cam to wear down. And the roller cams are expensive. I priced them, and they're about $185 just for the camshaft, and that's a Millings camshaft. And then the lifters are about $115 for a set of hydraulic roller lifters. So that's something you're going to want to pay attention to. You don't want to have to take the cam out of this thing in a few months after you've put it back in there. So another thing is I like to mark the castings before I send them to the machine shop. As you can see right here, I've got two little indentations on that cam, on that head casting. I've just got one on this one. And so that's for two reasons. One, I can make sure that I'm getting back the part that I sent to the machine shop. And two, it tells me which bank I need to put the head back on after they've cleaned it. Because when they run this thing through the cleaner, I'm not going to be able to tell which is which. They're exact same casting and everything, other than one side has the temperature sensor, and the other side just has a plug in it. Okay. You can mix match these heads. I could put this head on the other side and it wouldn't matter at all. It would be fine. But I like to do that because that's just what I like to do. So I'll do the same thing with the block. I'll put a mark on the block to make sure I'm getting back the same engine from the machine shop that I sent in. This is that balance shaft I was mentioning before. They call it a balancer shaft. I call it a noise dampener, because that's what it was designed to do, was decrease the knock. And you can see right here is the knock sensor right here. So that's what this thing does, is it dampens the engine noise. So that's about it. That's all I got for right now. I'm just gonna finish taking this thing apart. Another thing I wanted to mention, let's see, where is it at? Right here. Just one of them. There's several of these like this. Well, this one ain't it. It's in here somewhere. Where did I put it? Come here, you old bastard. Where'd you go? That ain't it. That's what I get for throwing all this crap at me. Where are you at, Munchkin? That ain't it. That ain't it. That ain't it. There's a bolt in here. Well, yeah, this is it right here. Okay, you can see this bolt. You can see how this bolt is, focus, you mug. You can see how this bolt is eaten up, okay? That's the way it came out. And it's really important that you pay attention and clean all these bolts that you take off this engine. Because the problem, what happens here is when I put this thing back in there, and I start to torque it down, it could snap right here where it's weakened, you know. And then I got to take the whole engine back apart and try to get the bolt out and tap it out without destroying the head. And it could be a nightmare for you. So it's important to make sure all your nuts and bolts are in good shape. I mentioned before that I wasn't sure whether the head bolts were suggested to be replaced. I still don't know. I haven't checked into that yet. But I'm going to finish tearing this thing down. And as I go along, I will tell you guys what I got going. Okay, another thing I want to mention too. Now, if I really wanted to get down the nitty gritty and make this thing run as good as it could, good as I could make it run, then I would, if you can see this or not. Yeah, you can see let me zoom in a little bit. Okay. You can see where that gasket material was seated on that head. You see how much space there is? Let me put this so I can put my finger and show you. Okay. You see this distance right here between right here and right here? Now I could take my die grinder and a special die, and I could remove all that material all the way around that gasket area where that gasket seats on here, because that gasket's going to seat right there, okay, all the way around and on every one. And I could do that, remove that material on this and also the intake manifold, which is over here. And you can see the gasket, you can see at the bottom down there, you see that black part? I could remove all that material and set that gasket on there, clean it real good, set that gasket on there and mark everywhere that the gasket doesn't touch and remove that material. And what that does is it keeps the fuel from coming in right here and beginning to pool in this area, because when the gas comes in and starts hitting there, hitting this edge, it begins to slow down and it causes the gas to start to pool, and it reduces the atomization of the fuel. So you could get a lot better gas mileage. If I took the time to do that, I'd probably add, I don't know, 2 horsepower, 1 horsepower. It wouldn't add a lot of horsepower, but it would add fuel economy if I did that. I don't know if I'm gonna take the time to do that or not. It's a lot of work, but it's just something to mention, you know, just one of those little secrets that race car mechanics don't tell people about. So, all right. So anyway, this is where I'm at right now. I'm just going to finish taking off these stuffing things, and I'll get back with you a little bit later. All right. Peace. I'm out. Okay. So I wanted to stop right here and explain a couple of things. Now, I've watched a lot of people build engines online. I really have, and frankly, I'm pretty appalled at some of the stuff that I've seen. I'm not perfect in any way, and I'm not the best or any of that crap, but I have always believed that I've been taught by the best, and I have not one time seen anybody use one of these, okay? This little tool right here is critical, and it is a tool. It's a sleeve, okay? A lot of you guys are probably saying, what the hell is that, okay? What this does is, whenever you take these rods off an engine, these are ARP hardened rod bolts right here, okay? If this thing's got, you can see how much clearance is here between the rod and the crank. You see that? If I hold this, if the threads are down on this where it'll touch the journal, if I hold this as far as it'll go on this side and drop it, it will nick that crank. It will absolutely damage that crank. So it's critical that you slip these sleeves over these rod bolts. Every time you pull a piston out or put a piston in, you just squeeze them together and slide them right over the bolt whenever you pull the cap off. Okay? Which I'm fixing to do right now. Keep your fingers crossed. I can't do this with one hand without dropping that rod bolt on the crank, so I'm going to go ahead and stop this. But I wanted to show, this is critical, guys, right here. This is critical to protecting the life of your bearing. If that crank journal is nicked in any way, it will destroy that bearing in a very short period of time. So within a few months, you'll be having a rod knot going, what the hell happened? Especially guys that build high performance engines that don't use these. I am... You know, they just stick the damn crank in there. I mean, they just stick the damn piston in the hole and run it through there, knock it down in there. And I'm just going, what the fuck are you doing? You dummy. So anyway, I wanted to put that out there. These things are so cheap, you can get them from any machine shop. I don't know if you can get them parts house or not, but I know you can get them in a machine shop, but they know exactly what they are. That's telling them you want a rod bolt sleeve, and that's what you'll get. So it's critical. I'm going to take this. I'm going to take these pistons out of here and look at these bearings and see if they're into the Babbitt. Look at the crank. I'm keeping my fingers crossed, guys. There is no ridge. There is no ridge on these cylinders. If you can see, there's none. Probably can't see it right now, but I'll show you later. But there's no ridge at all here. And it's looking good so far. So we'll see what happens. I am optimistic.